Google delayed the death of third-party cookies to the end of 2023. Meanwhile, consumers want more privacy online. How can advertisers navigate a cookieless world? Keep watching to find out. Hi folks, it's Ari from Sharethrough here with a brand new episode of Behind Programmatic Headlines. In this episode, I'll cover why Google is delaying the disappearance of third-party cookies, what that means for you advertisers, and some potential alternatives. Without further ado, let's get into it. Google's Chrome isn't the first browser to stop supporting third-party cookies. Firefox and Safari already did it years ago. However, Chrome has over 50% of browser share.
So I think the important thing, and what I've talked about in several contexts in the past, is to remember that third-party cookies today only exist on Chrome. And 40% of the internet exists outside of Chrome. So there's already a huge audience of people that's not accessible via third-party cookies. And what advertisers have largely done over the past 5 years that's been evolving, it was 5 years ago Safari got rid of third-party cookies, is they've largely ignored that change and unintentionally biased their spend towards Chrome users, which means, by the way, biasing it away from people who own Apple devices, people who own iPhones and Macs, which is a pretty attractive segment of consumers to market to for many products. So I think advertisers are relying on Google and are maybe feeling a sense of relief at this delay wrongly. They should still be looking at how can I reach consumers that don't have third-party cookies, if nothing else, because I want to reach consumers on Safari and Firefox.
So until they get rid of them, third-party cookies are here for a little while longer. But wait, what are third-party cookies? Third-party cookies are a small piece of code that are created when a user visits a site. The code stores their browsing history, settings like login, and any other piece of information provided or set by the user. Third-party cookies carry over to the next site that a user visits, whereas first-party cookies are only used by the initial site. Advertisers use third-party cookies to target and retarget ads, which is why if you left some shoes in a shopping cart, ads for those shoes could follow you around as you visit other websites. First-party cookies are used for things like email marketing, which generally perform better than third-party cookies, but can be difficult to get from users. First-party cookies can be obtained through site forms, purchases, or signups. Third-party cookies used to be enabled by default, and users would have to manually disable or clear them. But now, sites are required to ask consent from users if they can collect third-party cookies. What are cookieless environments? Apps and mobile games don't use cookies, and instead use something like Apple's ID for Advertisers, IDFA. Since the introduction of Apple's App Tracking Transparency Framework, ATT, users have to directly enable tracking between apps. Connected TVs are also a cookieless environment. CTVs use apps to access content, so there's no third-party cookies there either.
So in CTV environments, you know, you have user-level targeting. It's typically through an IDFA type of solution. The biggest challenge in CTV-type environments is more about conversion tracking, because people don't do anything on a CTV, right? They watch an ad, and they ultimately potentially convert via buying your product or going into the car dealership or whatever offline. And it's historically and still is very difficult to track the success of CTV. You are seeing some innovation there. For example, Sharethrough launched our QR codes product, which is really designed to sort of bridge that CTV to mobile divide. And I think there are other ways to do that. And not only are you allowing the user to action against your ad, but you're able to now track that and understand the effectiveness of your ads. And even if most users maybe aren't scanning your ad, you're still able to use that as a signal to understand like which ads are working better, look at different tactics in different markets and different underlying organic content environments. So you're seeing some innovation there. Most of the innovation you've seen on CTV is about trying to gather audience data so you can target the right user. So there's a more sophisticated ability to do that than there has been in the past to say, hey, I want to reach these types of users and be able to find that audience in CTV, because people have built audience segmentation based off CTV IDFAs. What's still really lacking is the conversion tracking. We're sort of early days there, and that's where the solutions like QR codes fit in. Yeah, so if a user's scanning it, you've immediately gathered one piece of data at least, which is that your ad was working. You know, a user watched it, right? And you can use that to compare different creatives, different channels, different times of day, different geos, and start to understand which ads are resonating more with users. Even if all those users ever do is scan the code and never take further downstream action. But beyond that, you've been able to also link now the user's ID on their web browser to the ID on the TV and help you build a device graph of understanding, oh, I actually know this user. They've been on my website before and they just scanned my QR code, right? So you can start to build that type of data. You also, I guess, understand something about the user. If I now know this user was watching this type of content, so I can start to build some information about them. They were watching a sports score. I guess they're a sports show. I guess they're a sports enthusiast, right? So it does allow advertisers to start to build more data about them. But I think realistically, we know that a low percentage of users will ultimately scan QR codes. It's not necessarily something that every user is going to do when they see an ad. So what's most interesting, I think, is to use it for comparison data, comparing one ad to another, one channel to another, one geo to another. Because even if you don't have a high scan rate, you can still compare relative scan rates, scan rate being how often a user, you know, scans the QR code. You can still compare those relative scan rates to understand how your campaigns are working.
What's the big deal with third-party cookies? Third-party cookies don't preserve a user's privacy, and demands for greater online privacy have users and regulatory bodies like the GDPR and CCPA pushing the ad tech industry for stricter controls and measures. This isn't fundamentally a bad thing, and the ad tech industry is wholly on board. It's just hard to fill that void left behind.
The reason advertisers haven't necessarily adapted to the lack of cookies on these other browsers is because their campaigns are still delivering and they're still potentially hitting their campaign goals. They're just unintentionally doing it outside of Safari and Firefox, right? And so they're limiting their reach, which, by the way, is making those environments less ad dense and less competitive. So if a marketer can find a way to reach consumers in Safari and Firefox, they're going to reach them at a lower CPM and with less ad load on the page because many marketers are concentrating their spend towards Chrome.
Why is Google delaying the Cookiepocalypse? Creating a viable alternative that respects users' online privacy and still provides performance for advertisers is rather difficult. That's why Google had to delay the Cookiepocalypse. Again, the original date was the beginning of 2022, then the end of 2022. Now, the death of third-party cookies is delayed to the end of 2023. The reason Google stated is that there isn't a viable alternative yet.
And Google's really stuck in a difficult position here because on the one hand, they want to support what consumers and regulators are sort of looking for in terms of increased privacy and controls. But on the other hand, removing cookies diminishes the ad tech ecosystem in its current state and potentially advantages Google, which creates an antitrust concern. So they're really stuck in this strange position, and I think we all expected them to delay. I think there's a bigger question mark as to whether they even ultimately do eliminate third-party cookies, or do they move in a different direction around maybe giving consumers more controls and transparency but still maintaining third-party cookies. You know, I'm not sure where that will go over time. I think regardless though of what Google does, there's still an imperative for advertisers to adapt to be able to succeed in reaching consumers who aren't accessible through a third-party cookie, whatever Google chooses to do.
And they want more time testing out their privacy sandbox and topics API. How is the ad tech industry reacting?
So I don't think Google delaying was a surprise to anyone in the industry. You know, if you look at what's happening with the regulatory environment, particularly in the UK with the CMA, the Competition and Markets Authority there, it seemed pretty clear that they weren't going to allow Google to do this on their original timeline.
It did not come as a surprise. And I think like advertisers are still like looking to adopt like some form of like alternatives to cookie tracking. Because like the implementations on, you know, privacy regulations is not going to change. It's just going to, you know, expand and increase. We've observed that like in EMEA specifically, but North America is taking more measure towards that.
Yet a few advertisers already started testing out some cookieless alternatives. What are some alternatives to third-party cookies? There's UIDs, which are similar to third-party cookies, but more privacy-centric.
You know, the most like similar kind of alternative to like third-party cookies are called like universal identifiers. They just allow the advertiser to maintain those like use cases that is just mentioned, like targeting, you know, managing the frequency management, some form of like measurement in a privacy safe way. But the good thing is that universal identifiers, they also increases the value of the inventory on the publisher side, because there's like that kind of sense of that idea of the users, the consumer, like who's like you know, browsing on the publisher's website to find content of like of interest, is going to give like his consent, like, yeah, I'm willing to share my email in order to access content. And this is really like the new value behind universal identifiers, because they're technically cookieless or don't necessarily require the presence of like a third-party cookie in order to accomplish like those advertising use cases.
Some examples of UIDs are the UID2, ID5, and Identity Link. There's also seller-defined audiences, which are much like the customer personas that advertisers use to guide their decision-making.
The idea of seller-defined audiences being first-party data that the publisher has acquired and can offer to a marketer to help increase spend on their site, right? And we're facing a couple of headwinds to make that really effective, and I think there's some good solutions. One is the actual seller-defined audiences spec from the IAB, which at least now defines a standard by which sellers can transmit this data to their buyers. The other thing is sellers need to get better at actually accumulating this data. I think there's been a bit of a block in sellers thinking around, if I'm not a publisher who can ask for a user login and password and maybe a credit card, then I don't have first party data, which isn't true, right? Like you do accumulate data about users as they use your site, even if you never proactively ask them for anything. If you can understand this user who I can track with a first party cookie looked at the following articles on my site, I can learn something about them from that data. And furthermore, maybe I can build lightweight ways to start to ask them for more information over time as they use my site and use that request to unlock more free content on my site. So I think publishers can really look at the value exchange they have with users and understand how they can get an appropriate level of data from users for the value they're delivering. You know, not every publisher is the New York Times and can ask for a credit card to use their site, but even if you're a smaller publisher that maybe can't get users over that hurdle, you can start to ask users for that data. So that's one piece, is publishers accumulating more data. Then how do you transmit it to the buy side? That's handled through the seller-defined audiences spec. But then the last missing piece is right now, if you put that data in the bidstream to DSPs, it really gets ignored. It's not something that buyers are actioning on today. And so that's where the exchange role comes in packaging and marketing that data, and being able to say, you know, we have a deal ID that consists of sports enthusiasts based on first party data across our publisher footprint of thousands of publishers, and go and market that to buyers to enable publishers to actually see increased monetization from that first party data, which of course then incents them to invest further in building more first party data, and sort of creates that cycle. And I think we're still, that cycle hasn't really started to get created yet, except for a few publishers that have really valuable first party data. You know, if you're webmd.com, you have some data that people are really interested in understanding about what kind of health solutions someone's looking for, and pharmaceutical companies are gonna go beat down WebMD's door to find that. But other than those kind of exceptions, I don't think we're seeing a lot of money transacting right now on first party data, but we have the pieces in place to make it happen. It's something that, as Sharethrough, we're investing a lot in, and we have some cool products in the works there. And I think a lot of other folks in the industry are investing in that as well.
Seller-defined audiences are created by the publisher or SSP. Some examples of seller-defined audiences are sports fans, financial readers, mobile gamers. Possibilities are endless. There's also cohorts, which are groups of individual users that share common attributes based off non-private identifying signals. For example, sports fans could have around 3,000 users, financial readers could be 5,000 users, mobile gamers could be 10,000 users. Contextual targeting is also an option.
Another one that is like kind of has been resurfaced and is not new is like contextual targeting. Because on the publisher side, you could just like leverage different form of like contextual signals based on like how your consumer is browsing through your website and identifying patterns and categorizing them under like, you know, a few buckets. It's just like typically what contextual targeting is and is not relying on any form of like third-party cookies. So this is great to sort of like expand your reach, and this is like applicable on any form of browsers, including Chrome, but also Firefox and Safari.
For example, if a user is on a site about tropical vacations, the AI can understand that and then deliver an ad for travel agencies, resorts, hotels, and more. There's curated inventory. SSPs sift through their publisher sites, SDAs, cohorts, bundling those together for advertisers to meet their campaign objectives. For example, if advertisers want to reach sports fans, then SSPs can sift through their inventory and bundle sites that sports fans are more likely to visit. How can advertisers succeed without third-party cookies? Advertisers can implement a privacy-first approach and use that as a guide for all their campaign efforts.
Imperatives that are moving away from third-party cookies. One is simply the fact that users use more and more devices every day, which essentially diminishes the effectiveness of third-party cookies. You know, if you're doing intent and brand marketing on your desktop, the user ultimately converts on their mobile, they viewed the product on the tablet, they saw an ad on the CTV, those are not necessarily able to be linked. There are some solutions that attempt to link those. But those kind of things have already been diminishing the effectiveness of third-party cookies. So I think even were Google to announce tomorrow, hey, we're never getting rid of third-party cookies, if I was a marketer, I would still be looking to implement cookieless tactics to reach consumers that aren't on Chrome.
You can begin A/B testing different browsers like Safari and Firefox. Safari represents a lucrative audience of Apple users, and advertisers also have a chance to lower their CPMs since most other advertisers are focused on Chrome.
So the fact that Google Chrome is just further delaying like the deprecation of cookies is just, I think, giving like opening like a window of opportunity for advertisers to further explore how can they pinpoint, you know, and find like their strategic audience on other browsers that don't rely on cookies.
You can also combine different tactics like contextual targeting and seller-defined audiences and testing out with multiple different combinations to find out what works best for your campaigns. Well, that's all for this episode. Will Google actually remove third-party cookies? And will ad tech find a viable alternative? What will advertising look like in a cookieless world? Let me know your thoughts in the comments below. And don't forget to like, subscribe, and click that little bell too for more behind programmatic headlines. This has been Ari from Sharethrough. Until next time.